So in particular, and I'm summarizing Montreal's argument here, what he says is the following. The way to explain this feature of the data is that the company as a whole has this goal of keeping the log prices to a constant spread. Now, why keep log price to a constant spread? Well, there's potentially psychological explanations that say we tend to perceive things on a multiplicative or logarithmic scale. We perceive things as being twice as expensive or half as expensive. We don't perceive things as being $10 more or $10 less. This is a psychological feature that we see not only in our perception of sort of social goods, like the cost of something, but also things like light, our perception of whether something is brighter than another thing. Okay. We tend to perceive those multiplicatively as opposed to additively. We're able to sense the difference between one paperclip and two paperclips in a way that we can't sense the difference between a brick and a brick and a paperclip. Even though the additive amount is the same, the multiplicative amount in the second case is much smaller. So the idea is that this strategy that Sears Roebuck pursues, whether or not it's conscious, is certainly a beneficial one for the corporation as a whole. It makes it potentially, for example, easier to sell goods by keeping the range not too large and not too small. Okay. And what happens, okay, as we grow as a nation over time, and as people cycle through the system of Sears Roebuck, as they cycle through the pricing system, okay, and we go from, you know, selling dresses that look like this to selling dresses that look like this, or women's clothes that look like this. People try all sorts of strategies, okay? If they were trying one particular strategy, right, if they had some really clever method, okay, then you would not expect the distribution to be so easily described by two parameters, okay? Remember, the two parameters for a log distribution is the mean and the variance. The log normal distribution is the mean and the variance. And in fact, if you believe Montreux's original claim that the price distribution is well represented by this log normal distribution, what you're implicitly agreeing to is the system is maximally disorganized. It's maximally disorganized subject to only two constraints, the mean and the variance. Okay. Obviously, the mean is going to be constrained because Sears is trying to target a certain market. The idea is that the variance is also constrained because Sears is trying to maintain a psychologically plausible distribution of prices, something that it's able to market well. But the most interesting step, I think, that gets made is not just that observation, but the observation that the maximum entropy distribution says that that's all that's happening. That's the only structure left in the system. All other kinds of decision-making patterns. So for example, presumably, if you look in that data and you look at the pricing, in fact, Montreux brings this up, you look at the pricing of guitars, right? You know, there's a couple of guitars priced here, maybe a couple out here, right? And maybe there's two right in the center. If you look at the pricing of dresses, right, maybe it looks like this. But overall, okay, all these different decisions that people make add together incoherently. And what you're left with at the end, despite the fact that there's billions of dollars in getting the Sears catalog right, despite the fact that one of the major corporations in the country is obsessed with this particular question, okay, all of the different strategies it pursues and all the different strategies within each division that are pursued add in some way incoherently. They add in some way so that all structure, all patterns that might have been left by somebody having a great idea about how to sell women's dresses or somebody having a great idea about how to sell guitars, all those patterns wash out, and what's left behind is a thermodynamic system, a system with a very small number of constraints. So out of great complexity comes great simplicity, and that's part of the reason why maximum entropy methods have such appeal. There's a kind of paradox that you should be able to describe, for example, a jungle the way John Hart does by simply constraining two things, right? The average abundance of the species, okay, and the average energy consumption of the species. If the open source ecosystem argument is right, it seems remarkable that a system that's politically fraught, that's socially fraught, a system involving students and faculty, you know, billionaires at Google, right, and 12-year-olds, okay, and some guy in Finland, right, it seems remarkable that you would even be able to describe all of the outcomes of those complex decisions by such simple models. But that's exactly what MaxEnt allows you at least to test as a hypothesis. Okay. So this brings me to a quote that I love, and I'm going to read this to you because I encountered this quote, in fact, before I came across maximum entropy models. It's a quote from a novel by C.P. Snow. So Snow was an interesting man himself. He wrote a famous book called Two Cultures about the clash between art and science. But he was also a novelist in addition to being a scientist, in addition to being a sort of public intellectual. And in his book, Light and Dark, he focused on a particular character, and this is the narrator talking about what happened to the hero of The Light and the Dark. He says, usually, decisions built themselves from 1,000 small arrangements, ideas, compromises, bits of give and take. And what he's talking about here is he's talking about decision-making by the British government in World War II. There is not much which was decisively changed by a human will. Just as a plan for a military campaign does not spring fully grown from some master general, it arises from a sort of Brownian movement of colonels and majors and captains, and the most the general can do is rationalize it afterwards. And I think that's at the heart of the kinds of arguments you can make using maximum entropy methods. The arguments you make say essentially like, you constrain a very small number of quantities, and you can explain potentially an enormous amount of richness in the system. A system that seems like it's impossible to model from the ground up. How would you begin to build a model of an open source community? How many different kinds of agents would you need? How many different, you know, internal parameters for the agents would you need? Would you need to sort of, would, you know, an agent be defined by his education level, his income, his amount of free time, and whether or not he's single, right? Or, you know, would an agent in the Sears Roebuck pricing scheme, would, you know, a CEO of Sears Roebuck, would she need to be defined by, you know, her experience within the field and the amount of time she put in and whether or not she had, you know, training as a psychologist? Okay. If you were to try to build sort of ground-up agent-based models of these systems, I think you would stall out. Okay. But instead, by looking at these aggregate qualities, right, by looking, for example, at the distribution of prices, or by looking at the distribution of language abundances, okay, you start to realize that maybe a lot of those details don't matter. Okay. A lot of those details wash out. The particular dynamics are not necessarily what you need to know in order to understand the system on a larger scale. Okay. You may be able to describe the choice of languages in the open source movement by reference to maybe one or two quantities, and you don't even have to know those quantities for any particular language. Okay. All you have to know is their average abundance is fixed and their average programmer time investment is fixed.